My dear brethren, glory to God for the opportunity that has given me to preach to you. For this morning, what we're going to discuss is about let your light shine. This morning, we're going to take a glimpse of the Great Commission. And part of the scripture reading for this morning, we're going to read in Matthew chapter 28, verse 19 and 20. The Bible said, "Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit." In this great commission of the Lord, actually, there are two things that are bound to happen. It's either, number one, we evangelize, or number two, we fossilize, meaning frozen in time and just memories of the past. So it is in our hands. It's either we go out or just be stuck where we are and say nothing at all. But before we dig deeper, I want to read to you in Matthew chapter 5, particularly in verses 14 and 16, where Jesus said that we are the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden, neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light so shine before others that they may see your good works or good deeds, and glorify your Father in heaven. Now, briefly, the Lord Jesus is just telling us that if we have faith, if we have this so-called faith in us, then it is telling us to flaunt it, to speak it out, you know. But before we even flaunt it, before we even show it out to the world, before we speak it out, there's one thing that we need to do, and we have to take a look at ourselves in the mirror and ask this question. Are we convinced, are you convinced that you are a light of the world? There was this instance where Jesus healed a man with leprosy in Mark chapter 1, particularly in verse 45 or 44. When Jesus healed this person, this man, Jesus said, "See that you don't tell this to anyone, but go show yourself to the priest and offer the sacrifices that Moses commanded for your cleansing as a testimony to them." Now, I was kind of thinking, why did Jesus tell this man not to go and tell to everybody what happened to him? Well, the obvious reason is that he wanted the glory to the Lord. He wanted the glory to belong to the Father, not to him, of course. Well, the number two that I was contemplating on, that, and this I will discuss in a few minutes, the question there that you are reading now is, why did Jesus tell the man, "See that you don't tell this to anyone"? If Jesus wanted all men to believe in him and be saved. Now, I came into a conclusion why Jesus tell this man. The conclusion is that Jesus wants you first, wants this man first to be truly converted in his heart. He wants you to experience his unfailing and unconditional love and the sufficiency of his grace. He wants to have a real and lasting connection with all of us, with you, that when you testify, your testimony is so powerful that even the skeptics would believe you. It is by the conviction of your heart that will fuel your inner being to proclaim Jesus in and out of season, instead of running around immediately because of the hype feeling, which will only last for a short while. You know, but before we go and evangelize others, here's one thing that you and I should do. We need first to evangelize ourselves. Evangelizing me. We need to, you know, to truly sink in, to truly absorb all that we learn about Jesus. We need to convert ourselves first before we go around and proclaiming the Lord Jesus Christ to others, so that when we come face to face with other people, they won't see any log in our eyes. Where Jesus said, remove the log first, get rid of the log in your eye, in Matthew chapter 7, verse 5. Let us remind ourselves that you should love yourself enough for Jesus so you can give the same love to others. Remember, you cannot give what you don't have. Having said this, my brethren, we need to go back to where we were before. We need to understand, we need to realize what was our state before we came to know our Lord Jesus Christ. The Bible said in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 12, remember that at the time you were separate from Christ. We were excluded from citizenship in Israel and foreigners to the covenants of the promise. We are without God. We are without hope in this world. And in Colossians chapter 1, verses 12 and 13, giving thanks to the Father who has qualified you to share in the inheritance of the saints in the light, he has rescued us from the dominion of the darkness and brought us into the kingdom of his beloved Son. You see, our state before we came to know Jesus is that we don't have any hope. We don't have any God in this world, and we are living in the darkness. But because of Jesus, because of someone told you about Jesus, we are now from darkness, we are now in the light. From having no hope, from having no God, we have hope and we have God in this life. Now, having reminded us again of our situation before and our situation now, we have an obligation. You have an obligation to rescue other people. Now, in Romans chapter 1, verse 16, the Bible said, for I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God that brings salvation to everyone who believes, first to the Jew, then to the Gentile. As you can see, I changed the word Jew to you and the Gentile to me. So let's go and read the passage again, changing the Jew to you and the Gentile to me. I will read it again. For I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God that brings salvation to everyone who believes, first to you, then to me. It was first given to you before you gave it to me. You were the first to be convicted. You were the first one to be converted. And then you gave that gospel. You gave that same gospel that you received to someone else. It was you first before me. That's why we have in our hands a wonderful message, a beautiful story, a life-saving message from the Lord. A gospel that brings salvation to everybody, including you and I. In evangelism, there are two folds. In Ephesians chapter 5, verse 8, the Bible said, for you were formerly darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light. The second one, in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9, but you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for God's own possession, so that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who has called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. I told you a while ago that in evangelism, there are two folds, and that is to walk, doing, plus proclaiming, speaking. The Lord doesn't want us, doesn't want you to just live the gospel, to embody the gospel. He wants also for you and I to proclaim the gospel, to speak of the gospel. You see, so it is actually twofold. Now, remember, the gospel is walking, or evangelism is walking, walk as children of light, and proclaiming the excellencies of him. Remember in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 20. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 20, the Bible said that we were sent to speak for Christ. We are Christ's ambassador, and God is begging you to listen to our message. We speak for Christ and sincerely ask you to make peace with God. So it is not only that we should live by the gospel, we should proclaim the gospel. We should speak of the gospel. I remember it was a rude awakening for me. When I was in college, I met this high school friend of mine. And when we were talking, we discussed about faith. And I told her that I was baptized way back in the 80s, 1987 to be exact. And she told me that, "You never told me that you are a Christian. You never told me about Jesus when we were in high school. I know that you are a good man, but I didn't know that you are a Christian." Then, wow, it hits me. It's like I was punched in the face. You know, living as a Christian, I was not actually proclaiming Jesus to her. Then I remember the song. We have a song in the church. "You never mentioned him to me," right? We have that song. So it kind of hit me that I never mentioned Jesus to that person. So we not only need to live by the gospel, we also need to proclaim the gospel. So evangelism is twofold, that is walking, living by the gospel, and proclaiming the gospel. Do you have an idea how huge our task is? How huge your task is at hand? What will happen, my dear brethren, if we will not evangelize? What do you think will happen? Now, take a wild guess. Now, we will fossilize. Fossilize means we will be frozen in time and just memories of the past. You know what will happen? If we will not proclaim the gospel, if we will not say the gospel, if we will just keep quiet, this will happen. The death of Christendom. And this is happening. I saw this way back, and I want to share this with you. But before I go to one of the presentation, let me just read Romans chapter 10, verse 14. The Bible said, "How then can they call on the one they have not believed in? And how can they believe in the one of whom they have not heard? And how can they hear without someone speaking to them or preaching to them?" You know, we need to speak out. We need to tell someone the beautiful message of the Lord. Do you still remember who was the person who shared the gospel to you? If we will not go out, if we will not knock the doors, knock on doors of our friends and other people, how can they know of this wonderful message of the Lord? If we will sit down, if we will just be quiet and just wait for somebody to enter the congregation, We are told to go and preach the gospel and make disciples of all nations. Now, this is happening. This is happening. Baphomet. Way back, I think this was, I took this photo, or I took this from the internet 3 years ago or 4 years ago in Little Rock, Arkansas. They paraded Baphomet, half a man, half goat. This is a satanic activity. You know, they are on the streets. They are on the streets parading Satan and declaring Satan. And we have the Church of Christ. You know what? They have the Church of Satan as well. And they celebrated their 50th anniversary way back 2016. And they have their own satanic statements. They have the 9 satanic statements. In number 8, they said that Satan represents all of the so-called sins, as they all lead to physical, mental, or emotional gratification. You see, they are very proud. They are very proud of what they are doing. They are going around trying to get members, trying to get people into their so-called organization, you know, living in sin. Now, my dear brothers and sisters, we should stop making excuses. Do we want this to happen? Do we want to raise our children in a community wherein these are happening? Satan, demonic activities all around us. Of course, we don't want that to happen. That's why we must be ever vigilant. We must live by the gospel, and we must speak of the gospel. Be ever vigilant, my dear brothers and sisters. 1 Corinthians 11, 14 and 15. And no wonder, for Satan himself masquerades as an angel of light. It's not surprising then if his servants also masquerade as servants of righteousness. Their end will be what their actions deserve. You see, we can see all around us like angels, but actually they are devils. They're masquerading as an angel of light. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 4. The God of this age has blinded the minds of unbelievers so they cannot see the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. If we will let these people go around proclaiming Satan, you know, this will happen. This will happen. All of us will be blinded. We will be all be blinded, and we will worship the devil, and we don't want that to happen. We are called to be bold. We are called to speak up. We are called to speak out. Let your light so shine before men, my dear brothers and sisters. Let us go out. Let us be bold. Be bold for the Lord, my dear brothers. No, let us not just keep quiet. Let us not wait for people to come in the church. Let us go out and meet them on the streets, in the streets, and bring them into the fold of the Lord. In Acts, 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 12. And I will keep on doing what I am doing in order to cut the ground from under those who want an opportunity to be considered equal with us in the things they boast about. You know, Apostle Paul, he will keep on doing what he is doing. For such people are false apostles, deceitful workers, masquerading as apostles of Christ. He wants to cut them off. You see, he will do whatever it is in his power so that he will expose these people, this kind of people, masquerading as apostles of Christ. Acts 26, verse 18. We must be bold enough. We must speak out, speak up loud, to open their eyes, to open the people's eyes, so they may turn from darkness to light and from the power of Satan to God. Then they will receive forgiveness for their sins and be given a place among God's people who are set apart for faith in me. My dear brothers and sisters, if we will just sit down, this will happen. People will still be living in darkness. You will still be living in darkness. I will be still living in darkness. I will go directly to hell if no one preaches to me the gospel of the Lord. In the Great Commission, there is work to be done by all Christians. It is not great omissions. We are commissioned to build this kingdom by making disciples through evangelism, not just to build beautiful church buildings. Of course, we all want a big, air-conditioned building, but you know, the Lord's commission for us is to first to build his kingdom here on earth, and everything will follow. No. So our first assignment, we were commissioned to build his kingdom by making disciples. You know, what makes the Great Commission great is because it was commanded by a great God. Go ye, therefore, is not an option, but a command to be obeyed. I hope we get the idea of the Great Commission, that it's not an option for us. It's either, or we might think that, will I do it or not? It is a command by the Lord to be obeyed by us. My dear brothers and sisters, the responsibility of proclaiming the gospel not only fall upon the shoulders of the church ministers, not only fall upon the shoulders of the elders or the deacons or the preachers, the pastors, the priests. It falls upon all of us. We are all responsible in doing it. Now try to remember who was the person who brought you the gospel. Can you still remember the person that brought you the gospel? I remember mine. It was my sister Mary Jean. She brought to me the gospel of the Lord when I was in high school, when I was in first year high school, way back in 1986, long ago. You know, she brought me the gospel along with my cousins. Can you imagine, without that person bringing you the gospel, you may still be lost. I may still be lost without hope and without God, according to Ephesians chapter 2, verse 12. No. But because of that person's love for Jesus and that person's love for you, you are now a saved man. Now, I want you to think that for a while. I want you to think that deeply. And what does that tell you? It tells you to do the same thing. Don't keep the gospel to yourself. Good news is never a good news if you keep that to yourself. You must share the good news of the Lord. And sharing the good news, it is our responsibility to go and preach the gospel. Someone did the same thing to you back then. So it is now your responsibility. It is now my responsibility to tell the gospel to someone else. My dear brothers and sisters, let us continue. Let us continue our journey with God. If you ever feel that your faith is dwindling down or your faith is going down the drain, I urge you to talk to your brother, to your sister, to help you rekindle your faith. If you are sick, let the congregation pray for you. If someone here watching us, listening, if someone here has not yet received the Lord, I want you to come forward. I want you to unmute your microphone. Don't be shy. Let your voice be heard. Now, unmute your microphone and say it out loud that you wanted to accept the Lord Jesus Christ. Take the first step towards a wonderful journey with the Lord. Let the congregation, let the brethren help you in your journey. This morning, my dear brothers and sisters, let us all go out. Let us all preach the gospel. Let us make disciples. Let us teach the Lord. Live the gospel. Embody the gospel. Proclaim the gospel. Speak the gospel. In that way, we are building the kingdom of the Lord here on earth. Good morning. May God bless everybody.